is the Philippines.
And we are ANC. The Philippine Justice Department indicts suspended Prisons Bureau Chief Gerald Bantag for murder in the Percy Lapid Slay case. Maritime authorities say the sunken oil tanker that caused the oil spill in Mindoro had no permit to operate. The U.S., Britain, and Australia unveiled a submarine deal that's seen to counter China's ambitions in the Indo-Pacific. And the U.S. Federal Reserve forms an oversight panel to review the collapse of Silicon Valley Bank. Good afternoon, I'm Denise Dinsai. You're watching Top Story. The Philippine Justice Department indicted suspended Prisons Bureau Chief Gerald Bantag and several others for two counts of murder over the killing of veteran broadcaster Percy Lapid and alleged middleman Jun Villamor in October last year. It is now up to the court whether to issue an arrest warrant for Bantag and other suspects implicated in the killing. Mike Navalio reports.
Justice Department prosecutors have indicted suspended Bureau of Corrections Chief Gerald Bantag and several others for two counts of murder over the killing of radio commentator Percy Lapid and alleged middleman Jun Villamor. Bantag and his former deputy Ricardo Zulueta are tagged as principals by inducement in the two killings. Principals by inducement are those who offer money or reward in exchange for the commission of a crime. For the Lapid killing, self-confessed gunman Joel Escorial and his companions Israel de Maculangan, Edmond de Maculangan, and Elias Orly are tagged as principals by direct participation, while five persons deprived of liberty or inmates are considered principals by indispensable cooperation. Three are Denver Mayores, Alvin Labra, Aldrin Galicia, Alfie Peña Redonda, and Christopher Bakoto. For the Villamor killing, New Bilibid prison gang leaders Alvin Labra and Aldrin Galicia are also tagged as principals by inducement, along with Bantag and Zulueta. Six other PDLs are implicated as principals by direct participation. They are Mario Alvarez, Joseph Giorfo, Christian Ramak, Ricky Salgado, Ronnie De La Cruz, and Joel Reyes. Prosecutors found probable cause to charge the respondents for the Lapid murder, relying largely on the extrajudicial confession of Escorial. Escorial admitted shooting Lapid outside his subdivision in Las Piñas on October 3, 2022, with the Maculangan brothers and a certain Orly, who remain at large, in exchange for 550,000 pesos. Escorial pointed to Bakoto and his name Villamor as the ones who allegedly contacted him to kill Lapid. Prosecutors said they found evidence of receipt and distribution of money. They also said that without the cooperation of the PDLs, the killing could not have been achieved. While the PDLs identified Zulueta as the person who allegedly called one of the PDLs to give orders to assassinate Lapid, there was no direct evidence linking Bantag to the killing. But prosecutors cited several circumstantial evidence indicating Bantag's involvement, such as mention of the term itaas and tanda to supposedly refer to Bantag, apart from Zulueta's close relationship to him. As for the Villamor killing, prosecutors gave way to the so-called dying declaration that Villamor made to his sister through a Facebook chat just before he was killed inside the NVP on October 18, 2022, disclosing who were supposedly involved in his death.
Meanwhile, attorney Rocky Balisong, Bantag's lawyer, said they will file the necessary pleadings after reviewing the resolution. MT Princess Express, the sunken tanker that caused the massive oil spill in Oriental Mindoro, had no permit to operate. This was discovered during the Senate's probe on the incident. The Maritime Industry Authority says the ship's owner, RDC Rail Marine Services, had a pending application to amend its Certificate of Public Convenience. The CPC needs to be amended to allow a new vessel to operate.
I want them to explain.
Diba lahat ng barko bago maglayag, may sumasampa na miyembro ng Coast Guard para inspeksyonin yung mga papeles, walang tao nandoon at kuwaneng karga. We didn't do that, right? If you did that, then malalaman nyo na wala silang permit to operate pala. E wala, saan na nangyayang ko spring ngayon?
I think the company has permit to operate, but every time you have a new vessel, you get another permit for that vessel.
The owner says the sunken oil tanker was purchased in 2022. It sailed 9 times pending an amended certificate. Senators are also growing more concerned over the impact of the oil spill to the environment and livelihood of fishermen in Oriental Mindoro. Senator Cynthia Villar says it's a setback to efforts to strengthen the country's ecosystem.
Based on reports, the oil spill threatens around 21 locally managed marine protected areas, including the Verde Island Passage, which is the center of the global shore fish biodiversity. And this happened while there are pending bills poised to give Verde Island as a legislated protected area.
According to the Office of Civil Defense, a total of 108,000 people in Palawan and Oriental Mindoro have been affected by the oil spill. Some 122 individuals have also gotten sick.
To date, about 4,125 liters of oily water mixtures and 12,685 liters of waste have been collected from the cleanup operations. Due to the effects of the oil spill, 9 cities or municipalities in Oriental Mindoro have declared a state of calamity.
I'm here to find out if laws are sufficient to hold people responsible for the oil spill liable for what has happened. Can they be held civilly or criminally liable? The Pomo oil spill means so much more to our country than any other country. Kasi nga po, tayo ay isang archipelago.
A Philippine lawmaker says the owner of the sunken tanker that caused the spill in Oriental Mindoro is liable under several international conventions. Citing the 1992 International Convention on Civil Liability for Oil Pollution Damage, Aklan Representative Teodorico Jaresco says RDC Rail Marine Services should pay some 330 million pesos in damages. He says beyond cleanups, the owner of the tanker should be held accountable for damaging tourism sites and marine resources. An environmental law expert also urges government to demand payment over the oil spill.
Palagi tayong nagkukulang sa demanda. Dapat kasi papabayarin natin sila, hindi lang ng clean-up, kung yung damage, diba? Yung loss of life, yung long-term damage, yun ang palagi natin hindi nagagawa. No, hindi pa appropriate yung ano din, kasi gusto mo rin malaman yung extent ng damage, diba? Lagi nga sinasabi nila na ano eh, ano lang pa, parang yung, hindi pa ito yung oil mismo na ano, na transported oil na tinatransport. Parang ito pa lang yung oil na ginagamit ng barko, di ba? Kailangan mo i-distinguish yun kasi kung yung cargo na yun lalabas na, nako, mas grabing pinsala, di ba?
Kaya nga.
We really have to wait until clear ang damage.
Experts from the University of the Philippines' Marine Science Institute estimate that the oil spill in Oriental Mindoro may spread to more critical areas this week. UP Professor Irene Rodriguez says the oil could reach tourist spots Puerto Galera and Verde Island in Batangas Province by Wednesday or Thursday. Rodriguez is urging local officials to prepare for this. In Verde Island, she says, food supply may be affected, with the area serving as a breeding ground for fish sold in the markets.
Ang pinakamaganda nito ay treat near the point source, so contain and remove very near the point source. So kung saan concentrated yung oil. Ang sinasuggest talaga ngayon ay in situ burning, if that is possible, considering na mayroon tayong Clean Air Act. Kasi yung in-situ burning, controlled burning of the oil while it is still in the water surface. Mm-hmm. Yung mga nakalagpas na po dito, pwede natin i-control using booms and skimmers. Mm-hmm. Naka-deploy naman na po ang mga booms and skimmers ng Philippine Coast Guard. Kung ano pa yung lumagpas pa doon, ito na ngayon yung may posibilidad na makarating sa ating mga coastal environments. Ito na lang yung gagawa natin ng treatment process, either still using equipment o kaya mano-mano na pagtanggal.
Philippine aviation investigators are searching for important parts of the Cessna 206 plane that crashed in Isabela on January 24. Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines Deputy Director, General Captain Edgardo Diaz said 11 personnel from the Aircraft Accident Investigation and Inquiry Board are scouring the crash site to look for clues and crucial equipment like the plane's propeller, engine, and emergency locator transmitter. Recovering these parts will help them piece together what happened to the doomed aircraft. The agency, however, admits it may take some time to retrieve and bring down the parts, saying it will all depend on the weather in the area. Rough weather had earlier hampered the retrieval of the bodies of the plane's passengers. In other news, embattled Philippine lawmaker Arnolfo Teves Jr. and six others facing criminal complaints. That's in connection to the firearms and explosives seized by police on the properties of Teves in Negros Oriental last week. Police executed search warrants in the lawmaker's homes in connection with several killings in 2019. Teves is still outside the country, even as his travel clearance from the House of Representatives already expired. For Philippine Senator J.V. Ejercito, Congressman Teves remaining in the U.S. is not helping him clear his name. Ejercito believes Teves's absence only breeds more speculation on his alleged links to the killing of Negros Oriental Governor Ruel Degamo.
Well, I'm hoping that he comes home as soon as possible and face the music. If he is indeed not guilty, then there is nothing that he should be worried about. And because of him being in the United States, a lot of people are speculating that, you know, there's a saying that flight means guilt, or just before the fatal ambush of Governor Degamo, it was a coincidence that he was there in the U.S. So he has to come home and face all the cases that are being filed against him.
As the chairperson of the Senate Committee on Local Government, Ejercito says he's personally disappointed over the supposed security lapses during Degamo's murder.
With these political killings, I think this is a black eye on the country's image. So the Philippine National Police, the AFP, all the law enforcement agencies really has to step up. Again, controversial nga yung naging intelligence fund during the budget deliberations. I'm hoping that they put this into good use. Gamitin nila ito. Nasa na punta yun. Pinaglaban namin yan para magamit nyo. And I'm very, very disappointed that there was failure of intelligence in Negros Oriental.
House Speaker Martin Romualdez says Congressman Teves called him Monday night from an undetermined location. The House Speaker notes Teves expressed fear for his safety and his family, citing this as his reason not to return home at this time. Romualdez asserts he assured Teves he will be given ample security, adding that he ordered the House Sergeant at Arms to coordinate with law enforcement agencies and prepare appropriate security arrangements for his return. Romualdez, however, stressed that Teves should return home and report for work immediately, since he no longer has the authority to travel outside the country. The speaker adds Teves should face the allegations against him inside the country. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. appoints Davao City Mayor Sebastian Duterte and Baguio City Mayor Benjamin Magalong as chairpersons of the Interior Department's Regional Peace and Order Councils in their respective regions. Job Banaha now joins us on the line for the details. Job.
Good afternoon, Denise. The Presidential Communications Office said Davao City Mayor Sebastian Duterte and Baguio City Mayor Benjamin Magalong are among those who will lead the Interior Department's Regional Peace and Order Council in the Davao and Cordillera Administrative Region, respectively. Marcos also picked San Juan City Mayor Francis Zamora as the chairperson of the Regional Peace and Order Council in Metro Manila,
based on the announcement released by the palace. National Capital Region Police Office Chief General Jonel Estomo and Alexei Musni will be Zamora's vice chairs in the region. Zamora already announced his designation on Monday. Also appointed as chairperson of the RPOC in Central Luzon was former police chief and Zambales governor Hermogenes Ebdane. A 2015 memorandum circular from the DILG tasks peace and order councils to create a 3-year peace and order plan to be included in the comprehensive development plan and open discussions on major issues affecting peace, order, and public safety. They are also tasked to recommend measures or activities that will promote peace and public safety in their jurisdictions and form a special action committee to address peace and order matters in case of emergencies. Aside from these, the 2015 memorandum states that the leaders of the regional peace and order councils can recommend sanctions against local chief executives who are giving material and political support to the insurgents. Meanwhile, Victor Oliveros was appointed member of the Sangguniang Panglungsod of Puerto Princesa City, while Raul F. Marcelo was named as the member representing the business and investment sectors of the Board of Directors of the Subic Bay Metropolitan Authority. And that's the latest here in Malacanang. Back to you, Denise.
Job Banahan with that report. Thanks, Job. Over 17,000 troops are participating in the biggest joint drills yet between the United States and the Philippines. Bianca Dava is on the line with that story. Bianca.
Denise, the Philippines and the United States are set to hold the biggest war games this year with 17,600 troops participating, according to an official of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. The Balikatan is the largest annual Philippine-led bilateral exercise of the AFP with the U.S. Armed Forces. Colonel Michael Lojico, the spokesperson of the Balikatan 2023, said this year's exercise will be held from April 11 to 28 in various areas in the country, including Palawan, Antique, and parts of northern Luzon. Out of the said troops, 12,000 will come from the United States, while the rest are Philippine troops. A 111-person contingent from the Australian Defense Force will also be joining the military exercises, while a team from Japan is expected to participate as observers. The number of participating troops this year is nearly double than last year's 8,900. Lojico said the Balikatan 2023 will include live fire exercises at sea, a first for the U.S.-Philippine war games. He added another new exercise to be featured in the war games include cyber defense exercises. During the Balikatan, the AFP will feature its newly acquired frigates, F-18 jets, and artillery. Back to you, Denise.
Thanks, Bianca. The Philippine Air Force receives a capacity-building training facility from the Australian government. The facility is meant to train Air Force pilots and personnel involved in close air support for ground troops in combat. The Philippine Defense Department said the donation is pursuant to the Bilateral Defense Cooperation Program signed last December 2019. China's warning over the expanded defense cooperation deal between the Philippines and the U.S. drawing mixed reactions. Senator Francis Escudero slams the Chinese government for interfering, saying the Philippines has the right to pursue a foreign policy that serves its interest. Senator Jinggo Estrada, meanwhile, says pursuing renewed ties with the U.S. does not mean the country will wage war against China. But Senator Amy Marcos is concerned the Philippines may get dragged into a conflict involving Taiwan. For Senate Minority Leader Coco Pimentel, there's a need to further study the mutual defense treaty between Manila and Washington. For an analyst, despite all of China's rhetoric, it's not keen on waging a war against the U.S.
Kung titingnan natin yung behaviors ni China, kumbaga talagang nananakot lang talaga sila. Kasi parang alam mo yung behavior ng mga bully, pananakot lang yung ginagawa nila. Aksidente na lang kung may miscalculation. Yun yung pinaghahandaan natin, yung miscalculation. But as of now, iniiwasan din ni China at ni US na magkaroon ng digmaan. Kasi yung ekonomiya nila na medyo struggling right now, Yun yung pinapahalagaan natin. Ating kailangan gawin is maging clever tayo sa ating diplomasya with China, no? More engagements, more negotiations to them.
Meanwhile, the leaders of the U.S., U.K., and Australia unveil a submarine deal in a move seen to counter China's ambitions in the Indo-Pacific. The deal is part of the so-called AUKUS project, which was first announced in 2021. Under the agreement, America will sell to Australia 3 nuclear-powered subs with an option to buy 2 more. A joint statement from the leaders also said the multi-stage project would culminate in the production of a new class of submarine, which will be based on Britain's design, built in the UK and Australia, and include cutting-edge U.S. technologies.
So today, as we stand at the inflection point in history, where the hard work of enhancing deterrence and promoting stability is going to affect the prospect of peace for decades to come, the United States can ask for no better partners in the Indo-Pacific, where so much of our shared future will be written.
We are bound above all by our belief in a world where the sovereignty of every nation is respected and the inherent dignity of every individual is upheld, where peace, stability, and security ensure greater prosperity and a greater measure of fairness for all, and where all countries are able to act in their sovereign interests, free from coercion.
Australian Defence Minister Richard Marle says they offered to brief China on Australia's nuclear-powered submarine deal with the United States and Britain. Marle said the Australian government called over 60 world leaders to inform them about the Trilateral Security Pact. China's foreign ministry previously expressed their objection to the agreement.
We want to be completely transparent with our neighbours and with the world about what we're doing and why we're doing it. You know, what our strategic intent is. You know, our concern about other military build-ups is that they happen in a manner which is opaque and where neighbours are left uneasy as to why it is occurring. That is why we have gone to such an effort to make clear exactly why we are taking the steps that we're taking.
Let's now check on the weather here in the Philippines with PAGASA forecaster Veronica Torres. Veronica?
Good afternoon to you and to all of our audience. As of now, northeast monsoon is still affecting Luzon, and we're still monitoring the low-pressure area. And it was last estimated based on available data at 370 kilometers east of Davao City. That was at 3 p.m. today. For Mindanao, we're expecting cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms due to the low-pressure area, while in Cagayan Valley, Cordillera Administrative Region, and Aurora, we're expecting cloudy skies with rains due to northeast monsoon. Better weather condition is expected over Visayas, although there are chances of localized thunderstorm. For Metro Manila and the rest of Luzon, we're expecting partly cloudy to cloudy skies with light rains. That's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. Veronica Torres.
Thanks, Veronica. Now, overseas, a state of disaster declared in Malawi's southern region following the return of Cyclone Freddy. At least 99 people have now died in the southern African country, with the death toll expected to rise. The storm also killed at least 37 in Mozambique and Madagascar. With more than 10,000 people affected, the cyclone has piled more woes on Malawi, which is also grappling with the deadliest cholera outbreak in its history. Freddy, which first developed on February 6, is one of the strongest storms ever recorded in the southern hemisphere and is now likely the longest-lasting tropical cyclone in history. Peru declares a state of emergency in 400 districts after a powerful cyclone battered the country's northern region. The government hopes to provide immediate relief to the regions hit hardest by Cyclone Yaku. It has killed at least 6 people and damaged hundreds of homes. The massive devastation in the Brazilian city of Manaus comes to light. A landslide caused by heavy rains left at least 8 dead and damaged several houses. Local authorities and residents continue search and rescue efforts for possible survivors. Up next, the Philippines sees a rising trend in HIV cases among children and adolescents. More news when we return. Watching Top Story, here again are the headlines. The Philippine Justice Department indicts suspended Prisons Bureau Chief Gerald Bantag for murder in the Percy Lapid Slay case. Maritime authorities say the sunken oil tanker that caused the oil spill in Mindoro had no permit to operate. The House of Representatives approves on third and final reading the proposed Constitutional Convention Act of 2023. And the U.S. Federal Reserve forms an oversight panel to review the collapse of Silicon Valley Bank. The Philippine House of Representatives approves House Bill 7352, or the proposed Constitutional Convention Act of 2023, on its third and final reading. The bill operationalizes the resolution of both houses number 6, which calls for a convention to amend the 1987 Constitution. 301 lawmakers voted in favor of the measure, while 7 voted no. Meanwhile, House lawmakers urge their fellow legislators in the upper chamber to give charter change a chance. On Monday, Cagayan de Oro Representative Rufus Rodriguez urged the Senate not to ignore the House initiative, which he calls is an expression of the people's consensus. Cabarina Sur Representative El Rey Villafuerte, however, says they would respect the prerogative of the Senate if it sits on the constitutional reform proposal. The Philippines has recorded over 1,400 new HIV cases in January. The Health Department said of the total reported cases, 79 were aged 10 to 19 years old, and 7 were less than 10 years old. All except one of the reported adolescent cases acquired HIV through sexual contact. 95% of all cases recorded in January were male. For an infectious diseases specialist, this data is not surprising.
Really more of the behavior among this age group. Na siguro nakikita namin dito, mga parents nito are not aware of the activities of these children or these adolescents, and at times they're also influenced by their mga peer groups, okay? And I think that's something that's alarming, because with that age group, they're highly vulnerable. Very difficult to control HIV in the Philippines. Thus, we have to do very important and drastic measures at the level of the community on how we can engage this mga high-risk group. For me, it's really education on proper sexual behavior, on how to protect themselves.
Veteran journalist Luis Teodoro has passed away at 81. The UP College of Mass Communication announced the news on social media. It said Teodoro, who served as dean from 1994 to 2000, was pivotal in fostering academic excellence, upholding integrity in the practice of media, and defending press freedom. Teodoro was the founding chairperson of Altad Media, a network of media outfits, institutions, and individuals. The National Union of Journalists of the Philippines pays its highest tribute to Teodoro. The group says the strict standards that Teodoro set for his students and for his colleagues will remain a guiding light. The group adds, Teodoro was always generous with his time and wisdom. More tributes pour in for the late journalist. Carlos Conde of Human Rights Watch says the Philippine media landscape won't be the same without Teodoro. For UP Dilaman Professor Danilo Arao, Teodoro's legacy of responsible journalism and truth-telling will live on.
Former students like me, we can only hope that we can equal. We can definitely not surpass him, but we hope that we can just achieve half of what he has achieved. The kind of legacy that he has left behind pressures all of us to make sure that his teachings will live on, and that his books, his and all of his numerous articles, particularly his column articles, published publicly, would be accessible to people, and that we will take to heart the lessons, not just of responsible citizenship, but of the importance of social change and being a voice for the voiceless.
A bridge connecting the provinces of Cavite and Bataan is set to begin construction later this year. Public Works Secretary Manuel Bonoan said the 175 billion peso bridge was originally slated for 2024, but the engineering design is now 70% complete. The structure, which stretches 32 kilometers, is expected to cut travel time from Bataan to Manila from the current 5 hours to just 2 hours.
Growth corridors kasi is actually in the southern, southern part of Metro Manila. Southern part of Metro Manila, and the other growth corridor is actually north of Manila. So with this bridge, I think you will have better access, actually more direct access between these two growth areas. And significantly, it will improve actually the economic development, not only in Luzon, but for the entire country. Exactly. Malaki yung benefits that has been derived. And no less than the Asian Development Bank has indicated that the economic rate of return of this bridge is more than 25%. We'll try to have this completed before the term of the president.
More world news. North Korea fires two short-range ballistic missiles toward the Sea of Japan. Seoul says the missiles were fired near the country's west coast and flew about 620 kilometers. This is Pyongyang's second launch in 3 days and the first since South Korea and the United States began their largest joint military drills in 5 years. Washington and Seoul have ramped up defense cooperation in the face of growing military and nuclear threats from the North. The International Criminal Court will reportedly open two cases against Russian officials over the invasion of Ukraine. According to the New York Times, the first case involves Russia's alleged abduction of Ukrainian children who were supposedly sent for adoption or to re-education camps. The second alleges Russian forces deliberately targeted key civilian infrastructure with missile attacks. The report comes following the visit of ICC prosecutor Karim Khan to the war-torn country earlier this month. Chinese President Xi Jinping reportedly planning to visit Moscow to meet with Russian President Vladimir Putin. Citing people familiar with the matter, Reuters say the trip could happen as soon as next week. No other details were immediately available. The Wall Street Journal, meanwhile, says she would also be calling Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky. That would be the first time the two leaders have had direct communication, at least publicly, since Russia's invasion. China has been offering to broker peace between Moscow and Kyiv, an effort that has been met with skepticism in the West. Iran pardons over 22,000 people who took part in recent anti-government protests. They were part of the over 82,000 people granted amnesty by Iran's supreme leader early last month. This gives a glimpse of the scope of Iran's crackdown on dissent after mass protests erupted last year, triggered by the death of 22-year-old Iranian woman Mahsa Amini in the custody of the so-called morality police. The protests marked one of the boldest challenges to the Islamic Republic since the 1979 revolution. More to come, a Philippine Bankers' Group allays fears over the potential impact of the banking turmoil in the U.S. Stay with us. Welcome back. Here's the latest on the SVB fallout. The Federal Reserve names its top regulator to lead a review of what led to the bank's collapse. Fed Vice Chair for Supervision Michael Barr will lead that oversight with results to be made public on May 1st. Chairman Jerome Powell says the events surrounding the SVB collapse require a thorough yet swift review. U.S. President Joe Biden, meanwhile, assures the American public the country's banking system remains on solid footing. Biden also vows to do whatever is needed to address the crisis, including imposing tougher banking regulations.
During the Obama-Biden administration, we put in place tough requirements on banks like Silicon Valley Bank and Signature Bank, including the Dodd-Frank law to make sure that the crisis we saw in 2008 would not happen again. Unfortunately, the last administration rolled back some of these requirements. I'm going to ask Congress and the banking regulators to strengthen the rules for banks to make it less likely this kind of bank failure would happen again and to protect American jobs and small businesses. Look, the bottom line is this. Americans can rest assured that our banking system is safe. Your deposits are safe. Let me also assure you, we will not stop at this. We'll do whatever is needed. Below 4%.
The Federal Deposit Insurance Corporation, or FDIC, which took control of SVB, has created a so-called bridge bank that will manage the deposits and assets of SVB. Back here at home, the Bankers Association of the Philippines plays down the impact of the SVB's collapse to banks in the country. In a statement, the BAP said the banking crisis in the U.S. poses no substantial nor material impact on Philippine banks. It adds local banks have diversified deposit bases that allow them to continuously provide liquidity needs for their clients. The group also says the Philippine Central Bank has measures for the country's banking system to withstand economic shocks. The Philippines posts a $5.74 billion trade deficit in January, the biggest in 5 months. It's wider than the December trade deficit of $4.59 billion, which was the narrowest trade shortfall since March 2022. Fueling the growth in the deficit, a 13.5% year-on-year decline in exports and a 3.9% year-on-year increase in imports. Economic officials have been expecting the trade gap to expand alongside increased economic activity as the Philippines remains dependent on imports for many products, including fuel. The Employers Confederation of the Philippines, or ECOP, warns small businesses could close if the proposed 750 peso wage hike is implemented. The proposed measure was filed by the Makabayan Bloc at the House of Representatives. ECOP says wage hikes do not even cover workers of the informal sector who will bear the brunt of the consequences.
This should be majority, 84%. This should be the farm workers, the ticket drivers, gig drivers, massive vendors, small businesses that they're not covered by this. No? So if you increase the salary to whatever, we're trying to avoid inflation. But to increase salaries like that if it is implemented, 12.5% inflation will be something that you probably have to contend with.
A member of the Makabayan Bloc, meanwhile, insists their call for a wage hike in the private sector is doable. Congresswoman Arlene Brosas rejected claims the move will be inflationary. She says this will drive public spending and help put food on the table of more Filipino families.
Hindi po totoo yan kasi halimbawa 48% ang makikinabang lalo na sa formal sector dahil yung medium and big corporations, nandoon po yung mga manggagawa natin eh. And alam nyo po, any amount ng increase ng wage para sa kanila ay malaking tulong. Lalo na sa nagtataas ang presyo, high prices natin ngayon. Hindi excuse yung hindi maibigay yung nang sapat yung o nang makatang ang makatwira na sahod para sa mga manggagawa natin lalo na ng mga medium and big corporations. Mm-hmm. When in fact data says na ang mga big and medium corporations ay kumita kahit punong panahon ng pandemya, meron pa nga nagtriple mm-hmm. ang profits. Mm-hmm. So ibig sabihin they can, ayaw nilang ibigay.
On the heels of the push for a wage hike in the lower house, the Philippine Senate President filed his own proposal seeking to raise private sector wages by 150 pesos. Juan Miguel Zubiri asserted a need to give workers livable wages amid record high inflation rates. He said workers struggling to get by despite constant labor is proof of a problem that needs to be addressed. Zubiri believes that an across-the-board wage hike can promote economic growth that cascades to members of the private sector. Vehicle sales in the Philippines continued to grow in February, but at a slower pace compared to that of the previous month. The Chamber of Automotive Manufacturers of the Philippines Incorporated, or CAMPI, and the Truck Manufacturers Association say the number of vehicles sold reached close to 31,000. That's a 27% growth year-on-year. CAMPI President Romel Gutierrez said the February figures are an indicator that the local auto industry continues to recover from the pandemic. The industry hopes to surpass the sales levels seen during the 2 years before the health crisis erupted. Switching gears now, it's a success for the recently concluded 95th Academy Awards as viewership rises for the second year in a row. ABC Network said at least 18.7 million viewers tuned in to watch the award show. That marks a 12% increase from last year, which was infamous for actor Will Smith slapping host Chris Rock on stage. Hit sci-fi film Everything Everywhere All at Once dominated the show, taking home the Best Picture and three of the major acting awards. Dozens of Brazilians dared to bear for this year's World Naked Bike Ride. Cyclists, some naked and some in minimal clothing, rode through the streets of Sao Paulo. They seek to boost awareness for biking in the crowded city, as well as draw attention to a variety of causes, including road traffic safety and the health benefits of cycling. Meanwhile, over in Sydney Harbor, over 1,000 people disrobed as part of an annual nude swim to promote skin cancer checks. Sydney Skinny was taking place for the first time since 2019 due to COVID-19 pandemic restrictions. Organizers, though, fell short of the record for the most nude swimmers, which was set in Ireland in 2018. China will resume issuing all visa types to foreigners for the first time since 2020. Starting Wednesday, all categories of visas will be available, and areas that required no visas during pre-pandemic times will revert to visa-free entry. The move comes after authorities last month declared victory over a recent surge in COVID cases. The looser border control is expected to rekindle a $17 trillion economy that has suffered one of its slowest growth rates in nearly half a century. The U.S. partners with a Philippine organization to improve the reading skills of Filipino kindergarten to grade 3 students. Under the partnership, Knowledge Channel Foundation will regularly broadcast existing learning materials. The resources that will be aired are co-developed by the U.S. Agency for International Development Advancing Basic Education in the Philippines program, implementing partner RTI International, and the Education Department. The program also hopes to ensure children will have access to quality education. In entertainment, the camp of actor-host Vong Navarro lauds a Supreme Court decision throwing out sex crimes against him. The High Court's Third Division dismissed the complaints of rape and acts of lasciviousness for lack of probable cause. The decision overturns an appellate court ruling that said the Justice Department erred in junking the charges filed by model Denise Cornejo.
Sabi niya, sobrang-sobrang happy ako. Ang tagal-tagal kong nating hinintay ito, you know. It's been a long journey. It's been a painful journey for him. And I suppose Mr. Navarro should not be faulted for saying that this is a vindication because it puts to right, you know, what should have happened in the first place. Proper order. Proper order. It's the Supreme Court which gets the final say. The cases shouldn't have been progressed. The Supreme Court was correct in making the determination that the Court of Appeals not only erred, it gravely erred.
And before we go, here's a wrap-up of the day's market action from Michelle Ong.
The market fallout from the Silicon Valley Bank collapse continues. A gauge of Asian shares dropping 1.7% on Tuesday to its lowest close since early January, dragged by weakness in financial stocks. While the U.S. dollar firmed up after erasing all of this year's gains as investors reassess the outlook on the Fed's tightening cycle, with the hope bank worries will force it to ease up.
What happened, it turned out, is the concentration risk was not on the loans, but on the deposits and the fickleness of potential depositors to panic. There was just an old-fashioned bank run done in a high-tech compressed manner.
A global investment banker who is also active in the VC and private equity space, Stephen Konyang, tells investors the SVB collapse doesn't look systemic and is not a bad loans problem. The issue, in fact, he says, is with the deposit side. But he says there is a lesson for the Philippines here.
What would have happened on Monday if the Federal Reserve didn't say the bank was sound? All depositors can access their money because we are reopening the emergency lending window. On Maharlika, you still want the profits of the BSP? I mean, shouldn't the idea be your savior, which is the central bank, cannot be too small? And it's never going to be big enough. Let us tread carefully with banks that will have, that are emerging here, that have a niche model.
For the day, the PSE index tumbled another 151 points to close back at the 6,300 level. First Metro Investments' Christina Ulang says there's still a lot of confusion and selling pressure spilling over from the U.S.
We don't really know what's going to happen because banks in the U.S. are still being sold down, and the short sellers are on attack. And some foreign banks are advising a sell on the rally. So that is something that is creating a lot of uncertainty in the emerging market space.
AP Securities Ferdinand Subido, meanwhile, says despite the recent fear-induced downtrend in local markets, investors need to continue focusing on inflation. U.S. key inflation reading out after trading hours.
That this might not be enough to justify a complete slowdown or pause in the rate hike cycle, because we have to take note that the reason why the Fed even got started with the rate hike cycle was because of inflation. So inflation is an economy-wide concern. So okay. It would not really make sense for the Fed to sacrifice the needs of the economy as a whole in favor of the needs of the few. We see the index actually trending sideways throughout most of first half 2023 due to the uncertainty still regarding interest rates and how this would impact future EPS valuations.
In corporate stories, Nickel Asia reports flat earnings for the full year of 2022 at 7.93 billion pesos as an 11% drop in nickel ore sales volume ate into the benefits of higher prices. The company also recognized gains from its equity share in its investments in the two HPAL plants. This is around 942.1 million pesos, up 69%. HPAL, or high-pressure acid leach, is a process used to extract nickel and cobalt from laterite ore bodies. Meanwhile, renewable energy firm Alter Energy Holdings making a big push for sustainable clean energy that's not just affordable but secure. Alter Energy is in the middle of its 1.5 billion peso initial public offer. Offer period ends this Friday, March 17th.
My concern is that we're still overly dependent on imported fossil fuel, particularly coal. Mm-hmm. And the fact that our Malampaya gas field, which accounted for almost 3,000 megawatts of Luzon, will slowly be depleted, and that will really be replaced by imported energy. So the more we could source locally is better for us for an energy security.
In other news, Mega World Corporation confirms it is earmarking 55 billion pesos in capex this year, up 19% year-on-year. Andratan's property arm is also targeting to hit 130 billion pesos in reservation sales with a launch of 60 billion pesos worth of projects this year. And finally, Semiconductor Ionics says its subsidiary is buying a 3.8-hectare property inside the Light and Science Park 4 in Malvar, Batangas, to accommodate its manufacturing and logistics requirements. Michelle Long, ABS-CBN News.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Tinsay. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thanks for watching.